Good morning, everybody. It's great to be back. I love to be here. I love to be in this town, and I love being at this church. I love the spirit in this church. I always feel like this church could overcome anything. And in 2016, you proved it. I know you had a rough year with all the storms and everything, but I just want to say to you, once you've lived over a storm, you're stronger for it. And I prophesy a great new year in 17. Good things are going to happen here. And I applaud you and I applaud your faith to get through this. I'm delighted to be back and I'm always honored to be invited here. I want to congratulate you also on your Read Through the Bible program. Your pastor shared it with me and I read this week's part of it myself, just to be familiar with what you're reading, the story of Jethro advising Moses to add the 70 elders. I hope you've read this. And then many of the description of the tabernacle and the law and things like that, it's all about the issue of the combination between leadership and holiness and the presence of God. It's a wonderful, wonderful passage. And if you haven't read it yet, then you must do so. Now, this morning, I'm going to be speaking on a New Testament passage and a different Old Testament passage. I'm not precisely speaking on that, but they relate because Moses himself struggled in his positions of leadership, and I want to talk to you about some of the struggles through which I've been, and I want to talk to you about an instrument that God has given me, and I'm sharing it with you. This new book is out, and it has just exploded for us. I'm so thrilled with this. It's my 15th book, and this book is selling faster and further than any book I've ever written. It's the first book I've written where people go to the book table, and they don't buy one or two. They buy 5 or 10 or 15 because they think of people that they should send it to, even a case, and I'm thrilled with that. I want to say this to you if it will relieve your mind in any way. I do not benefit in one way, not one penny, from the sale of these books. In fact, from speaking engagements like this, preaching anywhere, I take nothing. I'm on a salary as the president of Global Servants. That salary is set by the board of directors in a meeting which I do not attend. And furthermore, a group of people pay that salary. So it means that everything that I bring in, I donate 100% to the Foreign Missions Program at Global Servants. So I hope that you will go out to that book table when the service is over and spend yourself into bankruptcy. Buy these books until you have no money left for lunch. I believe it'll be a blessing to you. It's called 21 Seconds to Change Your World. And that 21 seconds is based on how long it takes, on average, to pray the Lord's Prayer. In a 21-second prayer, I believe it's one of the most powerful instruments of restoration and healing and prayer that God has ever given us. And I want to talk to you this morning about how it interlaces with Psalm 23. I'm not going to read from the book. That would be tedious. But I'm going to preach on the subject. If you want to know the rest of it, you have to buy the book. Now, here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray the text. The customary way to do this is that the pastor reads the text, then he has a prayer, and then the pastor preaches. But what we're going to do is pray the text, because the text is the Lord's Prayer. We're going to pray it together. I'm inviting you, don't just recite it. Don't just say it. Don't just repeat it. Pray the Lord's Prayer. If it's been a long time since you've prayed it, it will feel like a good old friend. So if you will, bow your heads and close your eyes. And right out loud, let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. I want to begin by sharing with you the backstory that produced this book. I waited more than 10 years to write this book, nearly 13 years. I went through some struggles. Coming out of that, through the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit and His inspiration to guide me into the devotional use of the Lord's Prayer in the 23rd Psalm. But every time I started to write about it, I just felt a check on my spirit. Not yet, not yet, not yet. And I waited and waited and waited. And then I realized what God wanted me to write was a journey and not a good idea. So I waited until I preached with Jensen Franklin at Free Chapel in Gainesville, Georgia. And I preached on this subject there in two different Sundays in a two-part series. And afterward, Jensen said to me, Dr. Rutland, you need to write a book on that. And it seemed like the Lord said, okay, that's the signal I was giving you. So we do you do a fast here at the first of the year in this church? Many churches do that. We do a 21-day fast at the first of the year. And I wrote it during that fast. Writing is long, lonely, difficult business. But this book was the easiest book I ever wrote. I literally could not write fast enough. And I believe it was because the water had piled up behind the dam. I'd waited nearly a dozen years to write. And so when we started, it just went. Here's the backstory. I'm going to be transparent with you this morning on a couple of issues, and what I have found is that everybody says they value transparency. As soon as you do it from the pulpit, nobody likes it. So here it is. I want to share with you, since I was in junior high school, I have struggled occasionally with seasons of what I called darkness. I believe that the better term for it would be depression, but I was a kid and I didn't know what to call it. It was just seasons, not when things went bad. Depression, if any of you have ever struggled with it or you have people in your life that struggle, it's not feeling bad when things go wrong. It is unexplainable. It's a moment where it seems like a black cloud just looms up out of the swamp and covers your life. And it is oppressing, it's depressing, it's filled with fear and loneliness. And so usually God has blessed me with an outgoing personality. I'm grateful for that. I love people. I like to be with people. I generally am a jovial person. I like to laugh. I like to be involved with people who are laughing. But when these seasons would come, it made me feel separated from that person. You have to go on with your life. You have to do things. So, and then later on in life, you're in the ministry. You have to preach. I was the president of a university later. You have to do the work of the president. You have to do those things. But so this inner self of darkness and loneliness and fear feels cut off from that public person that's laughing and joking and talking with people and shaking hands. It's a very ripping experience. When this harsh one, and I believe the last one of my life. By the way, I've not been through this since what I'm going to tell you about. I went through this about 12 or 13 years ago. I'm believing not only was it the worst one I've ever been through, I'm believing by God's grace it's the last one I will ever go through. I'm believing for victory. But I'm at a place now where I can share it with you. It did not come when everything was going bad. In fact, it came when at what, if you'll excuse a very secular word, it came at the height of what anybody would call success. I was the president of one of the fastest growing Christian universities in the United States. We were raising tens of millions of dollars, spending tens of millions of dollars. We built a new and beautiful campus at Southeastern University in 10 years. You can go online and look up Southeastern University. We built that campus when I was there. And it was gorgeous. It was growing. It was booming. And at the peak of that, this dark cloud came and I felt that I had become separated from everything in my life. I went into counseling. That's another thing that kind of freaks Christians out. When you say I went to counseling, you say I went in counseling, and people think, my God, he went to counseling. Why are we listening to him? But I don't understand the spirit-filled people who feel antipathy toward counseling. I don't get that. Isn't the Lord called in Scripture wonderful counselor? And I don't see why we would object to that. And maybe he has helpers here that are pretty wonderful. So I went to counseling. I always see these angry Pentecostals on TV that are railing on counseling. How counseling is not of the Lord and they're opposed to it. I always think the same thing, don't you? When I see them, I always think, you need counseling. So I went to counseling, and this guy told me that what the enemy of our soul wants to do is insinuate himself between us and our principal lines of intimacy. For those of us that are married, that one of those is our spouse. For all of us, it's our God. So if the enemy of our souls can come between that, it breaks that line of intimacy and it makes you feel that you're cut off. I was speaking to a college audience and I described this to them as like living your life in a phone booth. And then it occurred to me, none of them had ever seen a phone booth. But it's like you evidently have a drummer here that's so crazy you have to lock him up in a glass cage. But it's like you're living in that you can see out, people can see you. You have to go on with your life, but you feel cut off. Even as I'm talking, I can see people all over the auditorium nodding your heads, and I don't know if you're sending me the signal that you have dealt with this or you live with someone who's dealt with it, which is almost as horrible. So anyway, at the peak of success, the worst of these hit me. I am now convinced that there is a toxicity of success which is at least as lethal as the toxicity of failure. And if you're struggling and going through a hard time and your business is in danger, I know what you're thinking. I can read your mind. You're saying, may God curse me with the toxicity of success. But I do want to say it can be lethal. It's the reason you see these professional athletes and performers who fall into all kinds of destructive patterns. They're dealing with the stress, the tension of success. Look, you're a professional baseball player and you're playing in one of those games where you have 5 at-bats. And your first 4 at-bats, you hit a home run. Have you ever heard this phrase? You're only as good as your last at-bat. It's not true. You're only as good as your next at-bat. You hit 4 home runs in a row. That 5th time up is tremendously stressful because you know everybody in this stadium wants that 5th home run. They don't want to see you beat out a bunt. They don't want to double off of the warning track. They want that 5th home run. And that stress, that tension to maintain that is stressful. And at Southeastern, I allowed myself to get in under that, and it fell on me. And I began to have one of these seasons of darkness, serious depression, and struggling with it, and all the goofy things that go with that. One of those, if you've dealt with depression at all, is sleeplessness. And one night, and my wife was asleep in the bed. This coming summer, 2017, my wife and I will have our 50th wedding anniversary, 50 years of marriage. It's been a wonderful, wonderful blessing in my life. And in those 50 years, my wife has had 2 or 3 minutes of happiness. But in those 50 years, the toughest year we had in 50 years of marriage was this year. Because you're dealing with all this anger and loneliness and fear and sleeplessness. And one night she was in the bed asleep and I was up kind of pacing around in the house. And I very stupidly asked a question out into the air. Just said something. Now I'm going to tell you something. If you don't know it, Satan makes house calls. And you ask a question like that, he's happy to answer it for you. So I just said, am I going to pull out of this? I began to be afraid this was going to be the end of everything, the end of me, fear and condemnation and everything. Maybe this is the end of me, the end of my ministry and leadership. And I said, am I going to pull out of this? And his voice, the enemy's voice, came like a cold fist and just gripped my heart. And it was as real, it wasn't audible. I'm not talking about audible voice. I'm not there yet. But I mean, just inside, a terrible voice. And it said, you don't have a prayer. You don't have a prayer. And it just about buckled me. Seriously, physically. I nearly collapsed. You don't have a prayer. Now here's the good news. If Satan makes house calls, so does the Holy Spirit. And I'm a lifetime fan of boxing. I love boxing. Not doing it. Watching it. I want to see other people get their brains beat in. But what I learned is our God is the consummate counterpuncher. He waited for Satan to say that. You don't have a prayer. And instantly I heard the voice, his voice, and said, yes, you do have a prayer. You have the one I gave you. Why won't you use it? And immediately the Lord's Prayer came into my mind as if somebody had written it down and handed it to me. It was so powerful and wonderful to me, and I began to pray the Lord's Prayer over and over and over again, not once, not twice. I'm talking about praying the Lord's Prayer over and over and over again. I began to fall in love with it. I marinated my poor brain in the Lord's Prayer. I soaked my spirit in the Lord's Prayer. It was a surprise to me, frankly, because early on, years ago, as maybe some of you have, I sort of dismissed the Lord's Prayer. I kind of left it behind. Part of the reason was because of my highly liturgical upbringing. I wasn't raised in a church like this, an exciting, fun, spirit-filled church. I was raised in a very high steeple, tight collar, deadly boring liturgical church. And the Lord's Prayer, we said the Lord's Prayer every single Sunday. Every Sunday at the end of the pastoral prayer, we would say the Lord's Prayer. But we didn't pray it. It didn't have any power. It was liturgical. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom, yada, yada, yada. We could have been saying the preamble of the Constitution. There was no power in it at all. So I kind of moved away from it. I have a very good friend who's a Jesuit priest. And he told me, how many of you here grew up in the Roman Catholic background? Will you raise your hand? You grew up calling this the Our Father, and which makes a tremendous amount of sense. Protestants, listen to me, since it begins, Our Father, I'm just saying. So he told me that many Catholics laid aside, or ex-Catholics, laid aside the Lord's Prayer, the Our Father, for a different reason. It was because subconsciously, in their minds, it became associated with punishment. So you go in for confession, Father, forgive me for I've sinned. How long has it been since your last confession? 37 years. And so you say, okay, what did you do? I did something mean to Joe. Okay, here's what you do. You forgive Joe, do something nice for Joe, say 10 Hail Marys, 5 Our Fathers, and mow the church lawn. So he said, what in many Catholics, I'm not dissing Catholics, I'm quoting a Jesuit priest. He said, for many, many Catholics, the Our Father became the Catholic version of writing, I will not talk in school 1,000 times on the blackboard. So he said it felt like punishment. So what I'm saying to you is, it is neither dead liturgy, nor is it punishment. It is the only prayer that Jesus taught us. And it is brilliant in its economy of language. If we had a consortium of theologians from all over the world and Bible scholars who tried to write a prayer, imagine the civil war that would cause. And imagine the long, tedious, unbelievable prayer that they would write. But in response to a simple question, Lord, teach us to pray. Off the top of his head, in the power of the Holy Ghost, Jesus gave a 21-second prayer that speaks to every need of human life. So I began to pray the Lord's Prayer over and over again. When you don't know what to pray, a handhold, something to catch hold of. When you need an instant prayer, when you need immediate power, there is something in the Lord's Prayer that's unlike any other prayer. Then I began to blend it with the 23rd Psalm. And I began to pray them back to back, back to back, back to back, over and over and over again. I still do. It's great power. So let me talk to you about these two great devotional classics. One from the Old Testament, Psalm 23, and one from the New Testament, the Lord's Prayer, or the Our Father. Now here's a coincidence. They are both written 1,000 years apart by two Jewish men born in the same tiny little village. David and Jesus are both born in Jerusalem, in Bethlehem, near Jerusalem. And they are 1,000 years apart. So David wrote Psalm 23 1,000 years before Jesus was born. In all of the Old Testament, with the possible exception, in your reading this week, you have the law of God, with the possible exception of the Ten Commandments, but only possibly. There are a lot of people who mention the Ten Commandments. They have no clue what they are or no intention of obeying them, but they have heard of them. But in the entire Old Testament, probably the most frequently memorized and used portion of Scripture in the Old Testament in the Christian community is Psalm 23. In the New Testament, 100% the most commonly memorized portion of the New Testament is the Lord's Prayer. Now, here's an interesting thing. When I finished the first draft of the book, I sent it to a friend of mine. He's not a Christian. He's a Jewish scholar that lives in Jerusalem. His name is David Nekrutman. I sent him the first draft of the book. A lot of it has to do with the Old Testament. I wanted his view on it, and he called me, and we spent a lot of time on the phone. And here's what he told me. He said, did you know that in Jewish ritual, that the 23rd Psalm in Jewish ritual is almost never used in public ritual? He said, sometimes it's the last prayer at Shabbat. In some circles of Ashkenazi Jewish ritual, it's used for certain times. But he said, by and large, Psalm 23 is never used in Jewish liturgy. I said, why? He said, because it's unlike every other Jewish prayer. He said, Jewish prayer is plural. The God of the people of God, the God of the nation of God. It's all plural. God help us. God bless us. God defend us. But he said, listen to Psalm 23. He said, it's a window on David's intimate relationship with God. The Lord is my shepherd. He leads me. He talks to me. He anoints my head. He fills my cup. He said, we feel slightly uncomfortable with that. He said, frankly, the 23rd Psalm sounds Christian. He said, that's the way you guys talk. He even quoted an old hymn. He said, look, I come to the garden alone while the dew is still on the roses, and he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I'm his own. He said, that's a very intimate talk for the God of Israel. We're a little nervous with that. He said, now, the Lord's Prayer. He said, that sounds Jewish. I said, really? He said, think about it. It's all plural. It's all plural. Our Father, forgive us, provide for us, deliver us from evil. He said, that's it. In fact, he wrote an article on the Lord's Prayer, which was published in the Jerusalem Post, saying there is no reason any Jew anywhere can't pray the Lord's Prayer. So I thought it was fascinating. I was preaching at a mega church in Southern California, and afterward a lady came up to me and she said, I'm a visitor here. She said, I've never been in a Christian church before. I was deeply moved by that prayer. And she said, I don't quite understand why. She said, but I want to start using that prayer. And I said, of course. She said, but you need to hear me. She said, I'm Jewish. Is that all right? And I said, ma'am, it's a Jewish prayer. She said, really? I said, it was taught to an entirely Jewish crowd the first time. Not a Gentile in the crowd. Furthermore, it was taught by a Jewish rabbi who never met a Christian until after he died. The suggestion of that phrase went right over her head. She said, I'm going to start praying that prayer. So it is a deeply sensitive and emotional prayer. Now let's talk about the two together. How did they both begin? Our Father who art in heaven, art is King James English, but our Father who is. How does Psalm 23 begin? The Lord is my shepherd, but the Lord is. Your greatest equipment for victory in the face of any storm or flood or attack of the enemy or history or anything that comes against you, Satan sneers at you and says, what do you have to say to that? You look him right straight in the eye and say, here's my answer to that. The Lord is. The Lord is. The reality of God is the ground and foundation of our ultimate victory. The Lord is. He is our Father. He is our shepherd, yes. But beyond that, He is. He is. That's really all you need to know. The Lord is. They both begin with what philosophers call a statement of the isness of God, the reality of God's existence. Now, how do they end? Finish this sentence. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. So they both begin with the reality of God, and they both end with the eternity of God. In between every need of human life, every pain of human existence is dealt with inside of those. What is the point at which they connect at the very interior of both? If I ask a million Christians what is the most important line in Psalm 23, I believe that the vast majority will say, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. And it's a great passage. It's the most frequently quoted. I am there. But I do not believe it is the quintessential truth of Psalm 23. I think that is the first four words of the third verse. He restores my soul. He restores my soul. David was a complicated man, and he lived a complicated life, but he understood soul restoration, that God restores us from sin and from failure and from falling and from every other thing in life, including depression. He restores my soul. Life hammers us. I'm not just talking about huge things, but there are huge things. I don't know you. I don't know who you are. But in a crowd of this size and all the people at the other campuses and all the people that are online, there are women listening to this right now that were molested as little girls, and that is a soul, psyche, emotion. That is a wounding experience. How do we get healed of that? He restores my soul. But beyond the huge things in life, it's just the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. It's the nicks, the abrasions of life. That mean thing that your mother-in-law said to you. Wrinkles. Your spouse, that look on your husband's face. That eyebrow goes up. Makes a palm of your hand tingle, doesn't it? Am I the only one? You're driving down I-10 and some Yankee with Michigan license plates cuts you off. The Lord is my shepherd. He may be in Michigan, but he only visits. Those things in life get you. But the Lord restores my soul. He rebuilds me. He refreshes me. He restores me. He restores my soul. Now, what is the germ, the center, the nucleus of the Lord's Prayer? We know what it is. We don't have to guess because Jesus told us. After he taught the Lord's Prayer, the only part upon which he editorialized was forgiveness. He said, pray this, for if you will forgive those who have sinned against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you your sins. But if you won't forgive, he cannot forgive you. I was in a counseling session with an elderly couple, quite elderly, about 8 or 9 years ago. He had been a demolition expert for the Marine Corps in the South Pacific in World War II. And he had blown up, without being able to see it very well, he had blown up an enemy machine gun nest. And at the last minute, before he turned the knob to blow it up, he didn't have time to react or hold his. He realized the enemy had tied civilians across the front of that machine gun nest to use as human shield. And he said, Dr. Rutland, I blew those people to bits. And while his head was exposed, he said a child's arm came like a helicopter blade and hit him across the eyes. And he said, I'm losing my mind. He said, every night, listen to this, every night since 1945, he said, that child's arm hits me in the face. He said, I know it when I go to sleep. Well, I wake up screaming because that little arm, pow. He said, I've tried booze and pills and everything, and I can't stop it. He said, I dread every night of my life. We begin to work our way through the Lord's Prayer. We begin to talk about forgiving those soldiers, forgiving the civilians. He said, why do I need to forgive them? I said, forgive means to release, to cut them free. I said, the reason you wake up screaming from those every night, you're taking them into the bed with you. The way you forgive them, release them, forgive that child, forgive that little arm, forgive those soldiers. And I said, forgive yourself. He said, look me in the eye and tell me, do you think I committed murder? I said, no, I don't think you did. I think it's the collateral damage of war. But I said, what does it matter what I think? Thy conscience doth condemn thee. I said, what does it matter what I think? What does it matter what you think intellectually? Something inside your soul feels guilty. I said, quit struggling with it. Ask God to forgive you. Just ask for forgiveness. Let him restore your soul. Finally, I said, forgive God. And he said, that's blasphemy. I said, no, it's not. It's only blasphemy if you think God needs your forgiveness. Forgiveness does nothing for the person you forgive. Forgiveness heals you. Forgiveness heals you. So he said, forgive God. I said, look, it's just like saying to God, look, let's kiss and make up. Let's get over this. 5 hours. We worked on the Lord's Prayer in Psalm 23. He and his wife and I just over and over and over again. Not a year. I'm telling you, listen to this. Not a year, not 6 months, not 3 weeks. The next morning, that old man called me weeping. And he said, oh, my God, Dr. Mark, he said, it's gone. I slept through the night last night. He said, it's gone. He restores my soul. And the necessary ingredient of that is forgiveness. Now, let me just prowl through a few of the words here, if I could. One is the issue of sin. It is, depending on how you translate it, forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who have sinned against us. I don't have any trouble understanding that so far, do you? One is forgive us our debts. When you sing the classical version of the Lord's Prayer, you sing debts because one reason is because it fits the melody line. But it also is theologically sound. We're in debt to God. What would you pay him for 1 millisecond of your most depraved sin? We are in debt, so we release the debts of others. But then there's the word trespasses. When we pray the prayer liturgically, as we did this morning, we use the word trespass. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Trespassing means to enter in where you have no right to be. So there are people who have trespassed on our lives. They have gone into things they had no right to be in. And forgiving them, the Lord can forgive us for places we've gone where we weren't supposed to go. Lord, forgive me. I've trespassed. I've gone in places I wasn't supposed to go. Now, here's another word. If you will, write out loud, finish this part of the Lord's Prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. All right, how many of you said on earth, the preposition on? If you said on, will you raise your hand? That's almost everybody. Take your hand down. How many said in earth as it is in heaven? That's the people who learned the Lord's Prayer in the King James Bible, as I did. In the King James Bible, the preposition is in. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Subsequent translations change the preposition to on. I don't have any problem with it. And I'm not running for Congress on this, okay? So if you pray it on, that's a great way to pray it. If you pray it in, that's a great way. They just mean slightly different things. And so let me offer it to you. On earth is planetary. Thy kingdom come on the earth. That's a great prayer, isn't it? Maranatha, come Lord Jesus. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth. I'd just be happy if it would come on Washington. I just on earth, okay? But what if you pray it in earth? Now it can't mean the planet. The Lord's Prayer is not the journey to the center of the earth. What can it mean in earth? I prayed it a long time. I kept saying, what does it mean in earth? Then it dawned on me. What are you made of? We have this treasure in earthen vessels. Dust thou art, and to dust thou returnest. We're made of earth. So when you pray it that way, it is, Lord, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth. In the earth which is me, in the earth of my kids, in the earth in my in-laws. Oh, God, please. You pray it in earth, in folks, in folks. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth. If the kingdom of God and the will of God is done in the earth of people, then all murder and mayhem and racial prejudice and hatred and fear stops. That's the key to healing. The key to healing in any nation is the kingdom and will of God in people, in earth. Now, I want to say a quick word to the men in the house. And ladies, this may help you to understand something. Preachers like Jonathan and me and all over the world, we all preach men should be the priest in their household. You should lead your family in devotion, all that, and we preach it all the time. And then wives, thousands of women say to their preachers every year, why won't my husband lead us in devotions? I'm going to tell you why, and any man will agree with you. Most men, I included, we are intimidated by our wives' spirituality. I believe somehow or another, I know this sounds terrible, I think women have a knack for God. It's a struggle for men. My wife, God bless her, my wife, she's a devotional giant. You know what her dream morning is? To have 3 or 4 hours alone with God, with her Bible and her journal and her ballpoint pen, 3 or 4 hours. The average Christian man, you lock him up in a room for 3 hours with nothing but his Bible, and in 10 minutes, he's climbing the walls. We want to shoot something. You know, we want to do. So what men are afraid of is that they'll gather their families around them for prayer, and we're afraid we'll pray something stupid, that we'll embarrass ourselves, and we have this nightmare of our wife and kids behind us looking at God saying, not what he said, what we said. So listen to me, guys. Here's what I'm telling you. Gather your family around you. Read Psalm 23 aloud together. Pray the Lord's Prayer, and you're the priest in your home. Maybe you can think of a better prayer than Jesus did. Okay, I'm good with that. But on the outside chance that his prayer will work, try his. Furthermore, for men, listen to me. There are men that tell me all the time, and women, but men tell me all the time, I can't pray an hour. Some preacher, I would pray every morning for others. I can't pray an hour. Okay, fine. What you mean is you can't pray an hour at this point in your life. But there's no one under the sound of my voice. There is no one that can't pray 21 seconds. So all I'm saying is, yes, I hope you'll come to the place where you pray 4 hours, 5 hours, but at least start with 21 seconds. And pray. You can pray it all the time. Pray it all day. Pray it through the day. You're in some boring, horrible business meeting. Just sit there with your eyes open, repeating the Lord's Prayer. Because there's a great passage in it. Deliver us from evil. Deliver us from evil. I can pray it in. You can pray the Lord's Prayer before the shot clock runs out at a basketball game. I used to be the president of 2 universities. One, we played Division I basketball. I did it many times. Give us this day our daily 3-point. You pray that. Well, you've been very patient. Let me bring this to a conclusion. Then I do hope that you will go to the bookstore and get these books and get them for your friends. Let me conclude with this. Years ago, when I was in undergraduate school in college, Lincoln was in the White House at that time. It hurts me when you laugh at me. But I took a course in world literature, and the instructor was very, very young. He's just a few years. You know, you're in your bachelor's degree. He's got a master's degree. You're like 21. He's 28 or 29. He was young and attractive and fun. He made world lit fun. We liked him. The only fly in the ointment was He was a very outspoken atheist. He was a secular Jewish atheist. And he never passed up an opportunity to kind of blast religion and blast people that believed in God. We got to the poetry section, and he was lecturing on the elements of great poetry. When one girl asked him, "That's all well and good," she said, "but we want to know your opinion. What do you think? What do you think is the greatest poem ever written?" He said, "I know what it is. It's Psalm 23. Well, we were pretty shocked. This is atheist. So she asked, she said, "Why?" He said, "You ask me, I'm going to tell you." He said, "Last year, our 18-month-old baby daughter died of sudden infant death syndrome, SIDS. No cause, no nothing. We put a healthy, beautiful little girl in her crib at night. We woke up the next morning, she was dead." He said, "We were devastated." But he said, "The worst thing was my wife is a very devout Roman Catholic, and," he said, "I'm a non-practicing Jew." And he said, "We nearly got a divorce over the funeral because my wife wanted a priest." And he said, "I remember screaming at her, 'I don't want some old padre saying mumbo jumbo over my dead baby.'" But he said, "She wept. We nearly got divorced. Finally, I gave in." He said, "As they lowered that little coffin into the ground, that priest stepped forward and recited the 23rd Psalm, which is from my background. And he said, standing there for just a split second, he said, this Jew knew there was a God in Israel. He said, if even for a moment at the graveside of a dead baby, if even for a moment an atheist will know that there's a God, that's the greatest poem ever written." Will you bow your heads and close your eyes all over the house? With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, I want to just ask you four quick questions, very quick, and you just respond by raising your hand and then take it right back down. If you say, "Dr. Mark, will you please pray for me? I need soul restoration. There are things inside of me I need to be restored." It may not be depression for you, but there are things that say, "I need soul restoration." Will you raise your hand and then take it right back down? Sure, sure, sure. So many. So many. Second question. If you say, "Dr. Mark, will you pray for me? My prayer life is just not where it ought to be." Will you pray that the Lord's Prayer in the 23rd Psalm will move me to a new level? I just need to get started again. I just need to refresh my prayer life by using this great prayer. If that's you, then you raise your hand. So many. So many. If just in your daily reading of the Bible, when you finish, just bow your head and say the Lord's Prayer, it'll crank you back up again. Now, here's the third. If you would say, "There is someone in my life that I need to forgive, that I need to forgive." If that's you, then you raise your hand. Yes, 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 so many. And finally, this. It's a simple question. Are you confident that you're a born-again Christian? If you were to die right this moment, are you 100% sure that you would be in heaven? All of these prayers, all of this is worthless until we settle that question. If you'd say, "I'm just not sure of that," will you raise your hand right where you are? Yes, yes. All right, good. I see your hands, and God sees. Why don't you settle that this morning? When I say amen to this prayer, we're going to have a song, the Lord's Prayer. They're going to sing the Lord's Prayer. And as we sing it, I urge you, come forward and let someone pray with you for that above all things. There'll be someone here at the front, and you just come forward and say, "Please pray with me. I got to get this thing settled with God." Now, Heavenly Father, I thank you for this moment. I thank you for these precious people. And we submit it all and our lives into your hands. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.